first thing you got to do, and sometimes one of the toughest things, find yourself on the map. So I've done plenty of walk testing in my day, and finding the location you're at sometimes is a challenge. As soon as you click, you're going to see the dot went black. So right off the bat, the scanner is going through, it's doing it's initializing itself. And what we do is we skip the very first set of data. So what we found is sometimes that very first set of data doesn't have all the neighbor information in there. So for highest level of accuracy, we felt like if we skip that first level of data, we're better off. As you can see, as soon as it went green, I started moving my mouse because even though I was talking, I didn't want to interrupt the motion itself. So as soon as it goes green, you're good to start walking. You'd want to walk at a nice steady pace. As soon as you get to a point where you want to make a turn, then you would click. So as soon as I click, you can see the data fill in, and I'm trying to move my mouse at what I'm roughly saying is a standard walk pace. If for some reason you're walking along and you end up getting stopped by security and they're like, okay, hey, what are you doing? You have two options. I can come over here at the bottom. I can hit it on my pause button. If you only you're going to be there for a second because you know you're authorized to be in there and you just got to give them a quick heads up, you'd want to click a second time right on top of where your dot was, because you didn't move. You'd want to accurately represent that data essentially right where you were located. So with that said, I'm going to bring this up to a completion here at this end of the hallway here. So when I click on done, it's going to ask me, do I want to complete my survey and save your data? Yes, I do. So right off the bat, it's going to show me interpolation area. So this is essentially the heat map. And as I noted, we kind of excluded the stairwell. So that's essentially that whole functionality of the interpolation area is to kind of show what to include, what to exclude. Before I get into the data itself, I'm going to come back in here. Actually, I'll start a second survey and we'll just call this one demo two. I don't need to change my band information because I'm going to do the exactly the same. But this time I'm going to do a stop and go just to kind of show you the difference in between the two. So same concept. When I click on start, I got to find where I am on the map. I'm going to start on the right side this time. So your stop and go survey, that's going to be more when you only need specific information from specific areas. So maybe you only need to have information around like each corner of the building and like the core area, maybe some key areas that you're doing a full on survey, but you just want to collect data every so often. As soon as it goes green, data has been collected at that point. From that point, your walk speed doesn't matter. It's not collecting additional information. It's kind of ready for you. So if you're saying, okay, I want to go into this conference room, what's the data look like in the conference room? You click on it, you can see it goes a little bit quicker because it's just collecting data for that one location as you click. Maybe you said, I need to get something in the core of the building. So you end up going in this little conference room. It'll go black for a second. The more channels you do have, you may have it go black for an extra second or so, but that's essentially depends on how many channels you have loaded. Similarly, you can say, okay, I want to have one piece of data here. My walk, even though we connect the information, we're only collecting the data for that specific point. So I'll just do that one as my final one and we'll select done. Same concept. Do you want to complete your survey? Yes, yes, I do. Thank you very much. All right, so now we have our data loaded. Up here at our top left, this is our technology selector. So by default, it went to my 2100 megahertz. If I click on it, it's gonna go dark in color, so it's gonna be active. Here I can make all the changes. So as we can see, it's on 2100, it's gonna show all channels, all PCIs, and it's doing the RSSI by default. Alternatively, I can look at SINAR, I can look at my RSRQ, or RSRP, which is probably the heavy hitter for what most people will be looking at. I can come back and turn that off. If I did have, like, let's say for 2100, I had what, channel 2020. So if I also had channel 2050, let's say, I could toggle in between the two. Obviously, they all wouldn't have a ton of value for you. You'd want to see each channel individually. So you'd be able to go through and say, okay, I want to see just 2020. Right here is your quick drop down. Same concept for PCIs. This one just happened to have two different PCIs active. So I can see 439 look to be pretty dominant. and then I can see 284. It's in there as well, but it, you can see there are data spots that it was not dominant. So for this one carrier, they do have two, and 439 is my dominant, but I can see how the neighboring signals, or if I have pollution, if there's multiple PCIs in there, I can quickly and easily view that. And under the technology, same thing. I can quickly change to my 1900. By default, it's going to have all channels. I only have the one in this example, so no change there. PCIs, this one only had one PCI, so 439 was the primary for it. And then same thing. I can always change my RSRQ, RSSI, SINR, whatever I might want to view.